Good morning and welcome to the 25th meeting in 2022 of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. Before I continue, I am in the chair this morning because the convener, Kenneth Gibson, has had a family bereavement. I'm sure that I speak on behalf of the whole committee when I express our condolences at this difficult time for him and his family. The first item on our agenda is to decide whether we whether to take item 3, consideration of draft correspondence in private. Are members agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. The next item on our agenda is an evidence session with the Deputy First Minister and Cabinet Secretary for COVID recovery on Scotland's public finances in 23-24 as part of our pre-budget scrutiny. Mr Swinney is joined today by Scottish Government officials, Andrew Scott, Director of Tax and Revenues, Gary Gillespie, Chief Economist, and Scott Mackay, Head of Fiscal Management and Strategy. I welcome you all to the meeting and invite Mr Swinney to make a short opening statement. Mr Swinney.
Thank you, Convener, and may I add my comments to your own in relation to the bereavement that Mr Gibson has experienced, and send my sympathies to his family and to him. I welcome the opportunity to meet with the committee today to discuss the pre-budget scrutiny of the 2023-24 budget and issues in relation to the public finances. The preparation for the budget takes place against a challenging and highly volatile landscape with significant implications for our fiscal approach. From the COVID pandemic, Russia's illegal war in Ukraine and rising inflation, we are now in the midst of a cost crisis that is having profound impacts on households and businesses across the country, as well as creating significant strain on the public finances. That cost crisis has now been exacerbated by the United Kingdom Government's mini-budget, involving substantial unfunded tax cuts, leading to rises in mortgage costs, sparking turmoil in the economy, and which has been described as the worst unforced economic policy error in a lifetime. I wrote to the committee yesterday to share the Treasury's latest estimates of the block grant adjustment impact of the cuts to income tax and stamp duty land tax, which imply a £540 million net benefit to the Scottish budget over 3 years, including this financial year. I would point out that in the space of just 10 days, that estimate has fallen from £660 million, a fall of 18%. As the committee will be aware, these estimates should be treated with a significant degree of caution, as they are not informed by independent forecasts from the Office of Budget Responsibility. The estimates assume also that Scottish tax policy remains unchanged. However, the United Kingdom Government's mini-budget poses important questions for our devolved taxes policies. My judgment is that we need to take appropriate time and care to consider these implications as part of our annual budget process. As part of this work, I have established an expert panel of economists who will assess the impact on Scotland of the UK Chancellor's fiscal approach. It is also essential that we engage more broadly on the tax and spending choices that are before us, including our commitments, priorities and values as a government. Therefore, alongside the review, I will publish a discussion paper to encourage public engagement on these important and difficult choices on tax and public expenditure. The committee will be aware that the Office of Budget Responsibility is now expected to publish their forecasts earlier than the 23rd of November originally proposed. The OBR forecasts are crucial to our budget planning and will allow Scotland's block grant adjustments for 2023-24 to be calculated. These forecasts will inform our approach to setting the Scottish budget and provide information to the Scottish Fiscal Commission in order to inform their independent forecasts. It is vital that we base our budget decisions on high-quality information, and I am unreservedly committed to doing exactly that. I am keen to discuss and agree with the committee a timetable for this work on the budget, and we will do that in due course. The committee will also be aware that I am expecting to conclude the Scottish Government's emergency budget review in late October, the purpose of which is to identify any further resources that could be deployed to assist those facing hardship in these challenging days. I look forward to addressing any questions the committee may have.
Thank you very much, Deputy First Minister. So on that point, I think one of our key reflections that we must all have is that having clarity and understanding of you know, what will be the impact of budget statements and budget actions ahead of time is of critical importance. And I do recognise that there have been some changes in recent days and weeks. So could I just ask you just to clarify what we should be expecting? So my understanding is, on the basis of the correspondence that we've had from the government, that the emergency budget response from the Scottish Government will be on the 24th of October. Is that still the intended timing? And that is, will that be purely focused on changes to this year's budget? And likewise, are there any implications to the timing of the Scottish budget from the announcement in the last day of bringing forward of the OBR forecasts for the UK budget decisions?
On the issues in relation to the emergency budget review, convener, I intend to come back to Parliament in the week commencing the 24th of October, a particular date to be confirmed, to set out the conclusions of the emergency budget review. My view is, at this stage, that will focus just on this financial year and on any measures the government can take to support those who are facing difficulty, but also to wrestle with the in-year financial challenges that I set out to Parliament in my statement on the 7th of September, which are primarily arising out of the significant pressure of inflation and the issue of pay deals that are coming in higher than we anticipated. In relation then to the timescale for the Scottish Government's budget, we'll obviously be in a position, and this is an emerging picture, convener, as we speak, where I understand, but it has not been, I don't think it's been publicly confirmed yet, that the UK government will accelerate the information that was expected to be published on the 23rd of November. Obviously, we had been assuming, had that information been available on the 23rd of November, we could produce a budget for the Scottish Parliament prior to the Christmas recess, and that would be the subject of dialogue with the committee about the steps that need to be taken for budget scrutiny and the timetabling of that. Obviously, if that comes forward, then that provides us with a bit more time and certainty about the ability to produce a budget before Christmas. I would point out that under our normal protocols, we are required to give 10 weeks' notice to the Scottish Fiscal Commission of our budget event. If we wanted that to be on the 15th of December, we would have to give that notification by this Thursday. So obviously the 8th of December has gone if we are going to satisfy the 10-week period. I think I assume from the question you've posed to me, convener, that you share my view that we should go through the normal sequence of events and taking the independent advice and information that we should have, which would require us giving 10 weeks' notice to the Fiscal Commission. I think the final point I would make is just really for completeness on what information we will have available to us, because on that I am not certain what information we'll have available. Obviously, if we get OBR estimates, that allows us to undertake, we'll get estimates of the block grant adjustment. What I don't know is what information we will have about spending information, and whether the fiscal statement that we get from the United Kingdom government at some time in the next few weeks will give us sufficient clarity on whether there is any revision to the assumptions that we would be making based on the comprehensive spending review. Now, in all honesty, I cannot see how those comprehensive spending review numbers can be sustained given the fact that there has been £43 billion worth of tax cuts that are unfunded and there is market turmoil. So if market turmoil is to be addressed and £43 billion worth of tax cuts are to be sustained, there is going to have to be some rebalancing measures taken. And I fear that that will involve cuts to public expenditure, which will have an impact on the Scottish Government's budget and also on the assumptions that would be in the resource spending review.
Thank you very much, Deputy First Minister. And just in the first instance, can I just say that I do agree with your position that we should, as far as possible, carry on with our usual budget processes. I think that consistency, clarity and certainty are all vital components of a prudent and responsible budget setting. Can I just ask a couple of points of clarification? I mean, has the government had communication or correspondence with the Fiscal Commission regarding the level of data that they have or expect to have, and whether or not they feel equipped to carry out the budget forecast? And likewise, just another point of clarification, just you mentioned there that you're questioning whether or not the UK government's fiscal plans might need revision. Are there any potential thoughts about having to revise the Scottish government's resource spending review in light of fiscal changes? And is there a mechanism for doing that?
In relation to a dialogue with the Fiscal Commission, I had a discussion with the chair of the Scottish Fiscal Commission quite recently, where we were reflecting on these uncertainties, but not with any, not with any certainty about what information might be available to us. Obviously, my officials are in regular discussion with the Scottish Fiscal Commission to make sure that we are in a position, as far as possible, to satisfy the full obligations that we would have in relation to the provision of information. And I am, as I said in my opening statement, convener, wholly committed to ensuring that we do that exercise properly and fully as envisaged by statute and by agreement with the Fiscal Commission. Obviously, it is a bit of a it's a bit of a moving picture as to what information we may have available to us, and we will only have answers to those questions based on whatever material is published by the United Kingdom government and what certainties it would have. I am fairly confident, as things stand, and this is based on conversations that are now just about 2 weeks, 2 weeks old, that we will not have a United Kingdom budget before we have a Scottish Government budget. I'm pretty confident of that. So we will be dependent on what information comes out from the further fiscal statement that's expected in the next few weeks. In relation to the any potential revisions, well, obviously, if we've set out the resource spending review, which is an indicative direction of travel on public expenditure based on the comprehensive spending review and our assessment of appropriate block grant adjustments. Obviously, that does not translate into a budget. That is the exercise we are now about to do for 23-24. Obviously, if there is a change to the content of the UK's spending plans for the next financial year, which, as I said in my previous answer to you, convener, I fear is the case because of the unfunded tax cuts and the market turmoil that is being experienced, then that potentially could have an effect. And the committee will be familiar that the choices made by the United Kingdom government can have different impacts on our budget. A significant reduction in Social Security expenditure, for example, will not necessarily have a direct impact on the Scottish Government's budget. It certainly would have an indirect effect on the challenges that we face. But reductions in English departmental expenditure, health, education, local government, various other expenditure of that type, would have a very direct impact on public expenditure in Scotland. And obviously, as the committee will be familiar, ministers are obliged to balance the budget, so we would have to take decisions based on the appropriate balance between taxation and public expenditure in the light of those that data that became apparent, and also in the light of the block grant adjustments that follow from that.
Thank you very much. I'll just ask one last question before handing over to colleagues in the committee. And we've been taking a range of evidence from a broad range of different bodies and stakeholders in recent weeks. I think one of the most significant insights, certainly to my mind, was from the Auditor General, who highlighted the fact that the total payroll for Scottish Government across the public sector is around £22 billion, which is very crudely, half the Scottish budget. We know that the headcount increased by around 15,000 during COVID, and we know that the government has set out that it intends to bring headcount back to pre-COVID levels, but protecting the NHS. Now, I think we've had those broad statements, but it strikes me both in terms of the pressures that managing that payroll is critically important. We also know that the MTFS essentially assumed that the payroll bill would remain static, and therefore that would imply managing the numbers is the key variable there. So I just wondered if the Deputy First Minister could set out perhaps in more detail about what steps and measures may be being considered by the Scottish Government in the coming financial year. Above all else, I think that those working in the public sector, I think, require a level of insight and certainty regarding the security of their employment.
The first point I'd make, Convener, is a fairly general point, which is that the committee will be familiar with the length of involvement I've had in the public finances. I've been a minister continuously for over 15 years and finance minister for 9 years, and now coming back into this role. So I've got a fair degree of line of sight about the finances of the Scottish Government. I have never seen financial strain of the order that I'm wrestling with just now. Not in the aftermath of the financial crash in 2008, not even in the years of austerity from 2010 onwards. So this is of a different order. And it's a product of the extreme volatility of events that I cited, COVID, which led to an increase in the public sector workforce, the enormous disruption that's been created by the unwarranted and illegal invasion of Ukraine, and the impact of inflation, and it has been frankly and bluntly made worse by the backwash of the mini-budget, which has been a disaster for the situation that we face. So the pressures are absolutely colossal, hence why I've had to come to Parliament to announce reductions in public expenditure already this year, and I may have to do more of that in the period that remains. Therefore, the challenges that we face are very significant, and I understand clearly the need for reassurance to the public sector workforce about how we intend to tackle that issue. I've already embarked on discussions with trade unions about the strategic approach to that issue, because we have to take the greatest of care in building as much confidence around those approaches as we can. We undoubtedly, public sector headcount is going to have to reduce in the period going through the spending review period and throughout this parliamentary term. How that is done is crucial, and I want to do that in a spirit of partnership with our workforce. I want to be open about the steps that we are taking to do that. We already have in place recruitment controls, which are tempering any rises in employment. Obviously, if we put recruitment controls in place, it means that vacancies are, in some circumstances, not being filled. That obviously reduces the public sector headcount, but it does it in a managed and careful fashion, which is the approach that I would want to take. Obviously, we have to reflect in each budgetary event that we go through how we can best address these strategic challenges, and that's very much the approach that I will take throughout these discussions. But I welcome the dialogue that we are having already with trade unions in this respect, who have a clear and legitimate interest in ensuring that the workforce are dealt with properly and with courtesy and dignity, and that will be my approach throughout this challenge.
Thank you very much, Deputy First Minister. When we were in private session, I gave my assurance to colleagues that it would be strict and fair on time allocation, so I have to give way at this point. So I'll hand over to Liz to be followed by John.
Good morning, Deputy First Minister, and can I put on record that I do understand and I accept that your job is much more difficult as a result of the difficulties that the Westminster Government has placed upon the, particularly the forecast. I absolutely understand why you preface your remarks with that. In the debate that we had at the start of this session, when we were debating the Scottish Government's programme for government, you mentioned two interesting things to me in a dialogue that we had, namely that the Scottish Government is challenged with ensuring that we try to improve economic growth, particularly by increasing productivity. And you also put on record that you felt one of the great difficulties that we have is that the size of the Scottish working population in relation to total population is a major problem, I think was your words. And that's something that has obviously been focused for quite some years now by the Scottish Fiscal Commission. Can I ask you, Deputy First Minister, notwithstanding all the challenges that we do face, a little bit about your own economic plan to try to develop these issues about growth? What is it that you will prioritise as a Scottish Government in trying to improve our economic growth and also our productivity?
First of all, Convener, can I acknowledge the very candid comments that Liz Smith has made, and I think it helps, frankly, the quality of our discussion and the reality of the discussion, and indeed also reflect on the exchange that Liz Smith and I had in the closing of the Programme for Government debate on the 6th of September, which one of her colleagues reflected to me, and I won't disclose who the colleague was to avoid causing any disruption to their prospects in life, that it was one of the more thoughtful contributions that Parliament could do with a little bit more of, and I certainly am interested in engaging in that type of discussion, because I think we have got very difficult challenges ahead and there are not easy answers. And I welcome the timely question that Liz Smith puts to me about economic growth, because it allows me to illustrate the government's approach based on some conversations I had yesterday at the Convention of the Highlands and Islands in Oban, which of course brings together a variety of public sector leaders from across the Highlands and Islands. And fundamentally, the government's growth agenda is based on the National Strategy for Economic Transformation, which I would draw out a few key themes. The first is an emphasis on innovation and creativity. The second is an emphasis on the importance of regional economic policy. And the third is the importance of activating as many levers as we can within our control to support economic opportunity. So those are three of the big themes from the national strategy that I would draw upon. If I then move into the conversation I had yesterday with the Convention of the Highlands and Islands. In one respect, it was an enormously encouraging and motivating conversation, because we talked through actually a more buoyant set of economic opportunities than I have seen in a long time in the Highlands and Islands. So the ScotWind developments, for example, the prospects for technological development around the Beechwood campus in Inverness, some of the related energy activity that's going on in Orkney, Shetland and the Western Isles, and a variety of other economic opportunities. And the tourism sector as well. Huge range of economic opportunities. But the challenges that were identified, I think, would be best summed up by probably four factors. availability of workforce to actually deliver on these opportunities. Secondly, the availability of housing, to and not just affordable housing, housing at all levels of the market, and requirements within the market. Thirdly, the importance of transport connectivity, so issues about ferry services and other issues were very much to the fore of the discussion. And finally, digital connectivity, where I think there was a recognition that we were in a much stronger place than we had been, but we've still got some distance to go. And essentially, how we realise, so on the one hand, very substantial economic opportunities and prospects, but four pretty chunky policy issues, three of which I would say the Scottish Government can help to influence, one of which I think is a real shared endeavour and is a challenge, and that's about the availability of people. Because, you know, we're sitting just now with historically low unemployment. That might not be the case in the period ahead. We are reducing the level of economic inactivity in Scotland. It's slow, but I would expect it to be slow because invariably trying to reduce economic inactivity takes a lot of focused activity. But fundamentally, we are short of people, skilled people, and frankly, people who we could do with developing their skills. We are short of people. And this is, to me, the consequence of the loss of free movement from EU membership. Now, I pick up, and Liz Smith may be party to some of these discussions, I pick up some sense that the UK government is beginning to realise that the loss of migration is a problem, because I'm picking up elements of the dialogue within the United Kingdom government, which is recognising the whole United Kingdom is getting short of working age population. And I hope that that opens up some recognition of some of the steps that we've got to take to address that. So I hope that gives some of the flavour of where my thinking is on these measures.
Yeah, that's very helpful, Deputy First Minister, and it's encouraging to hear that there is some good news amongst the gloom. Notwithstanding these points that you've just made, and I come back to two of the challenges that you cited there, namely about workforce and about housing. In terms of trying to make Scotland a much more attractive place in which to live and work, as well as to invest, is it the Scottish Government's intention to ensure that the tax system, the levers that you do have with the Scottish Parliament, drives down the tax to ensure that we are not seen as uncompetitive when it is compared to the rest of the UK? Because that is an issue that is coming through a lot of forecasts. And if the current fiscal arrangements from the UK stay in place, there is no question that there will be difficulties for the Scottish Government unless they can match some of these tax changes. Would you accept that?
I think we've got to proceed here with great care, because I can't accuse the United Kingdom Government of proceeding with great care on these issues. And with the greatest respect, I can't accuse the Scottish Conservatives of proceeding with great care on this matter either, because, you know, within the last 10 days, I have been called upon to mirror tax policies that have now been dumped by the UK government within a matter of, well, it's more than 10 days, what is it? It's about 12 days now. But that's no way to be undertaking tax policy. It's a total farce. And so I think we've got to look carefully at these issues. Of course, the tax position in Scotland has a relevance to... there's a relevant relationship between the tax position in Scotland and the tax position in the rest of the United Kingdom. But so are the other commitments that people have access to, like significantly lower council tax, like free prescription charges, like the fact that their children will get more early learning and childcare in Scotland than you'll get in the rest of the UK, like your children won't have to pay tuition fees if they go to a Scottish university and you live in Scotland. So, you know, all the stuff about relative tax positions. Some of the decisions of the United Kingdom government for some people are completely incidental compared to the difference in council tax between Scotland and England on average. There's about a £500 difference in council tax between Bandee council taxpayers on average in Scotland compared to England, £500 lower in Scotland. Well, there's got to be really dramatic changes in tax before you start deciding as a Bandee council taxpayer that you're going to uproot all your family circumstances to try to get some degree of income tax advantage when you then jettison a whole host of other benefits to which you have access. So that's why, as in my opening remarks, I set out that I'm going to air that debate about public expenditure and taxation, because it's a rounded debate. We can't just have a compartmentalised debate about tax rates without looking at what's the whole public expenditure and tax proposition that people have in front of them, because that will affect, I think, many of the choices that people make. And finally, for the record, of course I want Scotland to be an attractive place for investment, and the record speaks for itself. Other than London, the South East, Scotland is the most successful location for foreign direct investment across the United Kingdom, and has been so for, I think, the best part of the last 10 years, if not more.
But Mr. Swinney, on the back of that, you have quite a large proportion of the Scottish business sector who, when the initial announcement came from the UK government, was actually very supportive of a large part of the fiscal statement, because of the fact that it was very focused on high growth and a low tax agenda, which was in contrast to many of the forecasts that we have in Scotland, which have seen fairly high tax, not necessarily with the benefits of good quality public services in the way that we would like, but obviously low growth. And I come back to this question that the business community is asking, and some of our very senior business men and women are saying, look, we really do want Scotland to have the same focus as the United Kingdom when it comes to that low tax, high growth agenda. And what I'm really keen to know is whether you feel that in the forecast that you will make for the Scottish budget, that you can apply that same principle of policy so that people really do feel that Scotland is somewhere where not only where they want to stay, but also to which they want to come. Because, as you rightly said in the debate and when we opened the programme for government, that there are serious issues about the size of our working population.
Yes, there are serious issues about the size of our working population, which is why I thought it was absolutely absolute madness for us to give up on free movement of EU citizens. And why we could, if we had to leave the European Union, why we couldn't have stayed in a single market is absolutely beyond me, totally beyond me. Because, as an act of absolute self-harm, it is beyond belief. I come back to the fact, I've been around here for ages. And 20 years ago, Jack McConnell's administration were obsessed, I remember it vividly, they were obsessed by the danger of the decline in the working age population. And I take my hat off to them. They were totally obsessed about it. They did all this work on the Fresh Talent Initiative. Jack McConnell phoned me as leader of the SNP to ask me if I would support the policy so that he could get good cross-party agreement. And, if we go back all those days, there was a lot of rancour between my beloved party and the Labour Party at the time, how things have moved on. And I gave him unreserved support. And it was a good idea, and it made a bit of headway. And then, in 2004, EU expansion took its place, and free movement of citizens was enabled, and our population started rising. And if I think about the community that I represent, my son's just left primary school. A third of his class were the children of EU migrants who came here 20 years ago, started working, came here as young people, met people, made their family life here, and their kids were making up a third of my son's school class. and they boosted our population. We didn't have to worry about our population for 20 years. We need to worry about it now. And it's completely and utterly self-inflicted. So if we can have some thawing of the attitude about migration, it would be a great benefit, because I can't magic people up out of thin air. We can work hard to try to activate people who are economically inactive. Yes, I commit to that. And we're doing good work on that. Great Pathfinder's been undertaken in Dundee and Glasgow about the activation of economically inactive people. But we're still short of people. Now, so that would help. When I then go on, Liz Smith puts to me that there are forecasts of growth in the United Kingdom. That's not quite what we've got yet. We've got rhetoric about growth. We've not got any forecasts. The forecasts will come from the OBR. And that's what we'll all have to wait and see what this adds up to. We'll all have to wait and see. Because if I look at the mini-budget statement, the only thing in there that was about growth, the one single policy initiative, was investment zones. That was it. Now, if the Chancellor believes that the OBR is going to come along and say, yeah, these investment zones are going to be the absolute dynamo, and that's going to deliver 2.5% trend growth, I'll say, well, good luck with that, because I don't think that'll be the case. Now, I don't want to foresee OBR forecasts too much, but the Chancellor will have to come up with an awful lot more of growth-related initiatives to substantiate an OBR forecast that would get to 2.5% on the basis of what we're experiencing just now. And actually, if the Chancellor wants to repair the public finances without spending cuts, the growth assumption will have to be higher than 2.5%. And so I think we've got... And then lastly, forgive me for the length of my answer, and convener, I'm not really helping you with your time management, but there's a lot of really important stuff in here. I unreservedly accept the importance of the Scottish Government having an agenda that is about realising those economic opportunities I talked about in one part of the country, in the Highlands and Islands, from my discussions yesterday. And we've got to take the steps to enable that to happen. So on the housing question, I accept we've got to look at what can we do to try to help that housing question. But if I look at some of the issues that are raised, housing developers in the Highlands and Islands will tell me one of the biggest impediments to them being able to build new houses is what? Availability of people. Because they just can't find them.
Mr. Swinney, I don't disagree with you about some aspects of the workers' issue. That's true, and I think you and I share the same views about the Brexit scenario. But it's not by any means all about that. It's about differential tax rates. And just you were talking about housing there. The changes in stamp duty down south will benefit somebody who's buying a house down there to the tune of something like £20,000, whereas if we weren't to make similar changes on the land and buildings transaction tax, it makes it more difficult. And what my concern is, Deputy First Minister, is that there are other issues at play in Scotland which don't necessarily make it particularly attractive for somebody to live and work in Scotland. And, you know, it's not just about this current budget scenario, which I agree there are many, many issues, particularly, as you rightly cite, the lack of adequate forecasts. This is not a new problem. This has been going on for quite some time, if you drill back on what the Scottish Fiscal Commission and other forecasters have been saying. So that's why I'm really interested in the direction of travel that the Scottish Government is wanting to set out to address the very significant issues of growth and productivity in our economy. It's not just about a Brexit issue.
I think on the availability of people question, I think it's fundamentally affected by Brexit. There will undoubtedly be other factors, but I think it's undoubtedly the key factor. As I said in my earlier answers, I think we've got to make careful judgments about tax policy, because we've got to be mindful of the legitimate issues that Liz Smith puts to me. But we've got to consider them in their proper perspective. And that's why I cite the other issues about well, what are the total housing costs that are available that are relevant? Property prices in England are higher than in Scotland, so people would have to be able to command much more substantial salaries to afford those properties if they were trying to buy them with a mortgage. And then you've obviously got the variety of other measures that are in place in Scotland that provide some degree of difference in the availability of public services in Scotland, whether that's about lower council tax or about the fact that you don't pay tuition fees or you get more early learning childcare or you don't pay prescription charges or whatever it happens to be. So there's got to be careful consideration of all of these questions. The final point I'd make, and it's an observation on the mini-budget, you know, the Chancellor took decisions to change stamp duty on the basis of stimulating the housing market in England as a consequence. The Chancellor has done enormous damage to the housing market in England because of the fiscal recklessness of the mini-budget and what it's done to interest rates. There's people, I'm looking at stories in newspapers about people who were all set to buy their houses and they can't now do it because the interest rates have gone through the roof. And these are young people full of hope about their getting on with their life. And with just total recklessness, the Chancellor has just shattered all that. Well, so you know, forgive me for perhaps just wanting to be careful about the tax decisions that I take, because on the basis of what the Chancellor's done, a lot of misery has been created to people who were about to take big steps in their lives and they've just had it taken away from them.
Okay, thank you.
I hand over to John, who will be followed by Michelle.
Thanks so much, convener. I've got a few questions here. Firstly, the fact that we had the UK budget without OBR forecasts, I consider it was a budget, whatever it was called. What is the risk in that of not having forecasts tied in with the budget?
I think we've kind of seen that for the last 10 days. What have we had? We've had mortgage products having to be withdrawn from the market because they will be fiscally unsustainable for lenders because of their expectations of where interest rates are heading. So therefore, you've got market disruption and people who had a reasonable expectation of getting a mortgage at one level of interest rate, perhaps now having to face double that interest rate, which obviously has an effect on the capacity to borrow that those individuals would have. And then that's been followed by a perilous moment of collapse for the pensions market as a consequence of market uncertainty. So the moral of the story is that the events of a week past Friday should never be repeated, of essentially undertaking substantial changes in the fiscal envelope without appropriate forecasts to show how they are sustainable, because there is a direct connection between those decisions and the market chaos that the Bank of England has had to intervene to safeguard pensions. And let's just think about that for a moment. Mr. Mason and I come from a political stable that's often had to set out our views on how we deliver sustainability in pensions. Well, the United Kingdom government came perilously close to destroying the pension entitlement of thousands and thousands of people because of the recklessness. So
is your understanding that they had the forecasts which warned about these things, ignored them and went ahead anyway, or did they just not even look at the forecasts?
I don't know if... I think I don't think they could have had forecasts about the implications of their tax decisions. I think what they had was forecasts of the condition of the United Kingdom economy and public finances. I understand that forecasts were made available. I understand this only from news reporting, I hasten to add, that some forecasts were available from the OBR when the Chancellor assumed office on the 6th of September. 6th or 7th of September. I don't think forecasts were commissioned of the particular changes that were made by the OBR, but I'm absolutely certain the forecast would have been run within His Majesty's Treasury, mm-hmm. and His Majesty's Treasury would have told ministers the damage that would likely to be done, mm-hmm. and I can only assume that ministers decided to ignore that.
I mean, it strikes me as totally irresponsible to do a budget without forecasts. I mean, is that something the Scottish Government would be allowed to do or even would consider doing?
Well, I'm not absolutely familiar with statute as to whether we're obliged to have a... I think we are obliged to have... I legislated for that, I think, actually, now I think about it. Yes, I think we are obliged to have that statute, and that's a good thing, yes. and that's why we should do it. Mm-hmm. And I just invite Mr Mason to wonder what the outrage would have been if I'd stood up and said, I'm not going to bother with a Scottish Fiscal Commission forecast, and I can think of some people that might have had expressed outrage about that if I had done so. Yeah. So I think for the UK government to do it, and I think, and I have to be candid about this, if I was to ignore a Fiscal Commission forecast, it wouldn't have quite the consequences of a UK government ignoring a fiscal forecast, or not taking a fiscal forecast, or not doing the job properly, because we've now seen the damage that's been done, mm-hmm. and our economic prospects have been set back very significantly as a consequence of that behaviour.
Yes, I mean, Mr Swinney and I both spent hours and hours and hours considering the Scottish Fiscal Commission and how important it was and how its forecasts were so important, whether they should be independent or whether they should be part of government. And it just absolutely amazes me that this has happened and that they did not take the forecasts into account. Now, something else you mentioned, Mr Swinney, was interest rates. And I'm just wondering, you've focused on mortgages and things, but how do the interest rates going up affect the Scottish budget? What's the impact for us?
The impact will essentially affect the... I suppose the best way to express it would be to say it will affect the purchasing power of the Scottish budget in the years to come. Because obviously if we are undertaking future borrowing, if we are in any way co-investing in a proposition with other interested parties, which the government does from time to time, then that will obviously be a factor in the consideration. And if we take, for example, some of the investments that our enterprise agencies might make or the Scottish National Investment Bank might make, these are invariably co-investment propositions, therefore the ability of other parties to co-invest, which we rely upon so that there's a sharing of risk, might be jeopardised because of these factors. So there's a variety of knock-on effects that we may face as a consequence.
Mm-hmm. I mean, just following on from that, I mean, I had a number of housing associations in touch over the weekend, and especially obviously in relation to this week's legislation. But one of the things they said, before the legislation came up, they'd already looked at cutting back capital expenditure in the sense of new houses, because even without the rent freeze, they were only planning a rent increase of 5 or 6%. And they were going to, one association told me that they are just stopping all new build, that they will only complete what they're doing, they'll do maintenance, but there'll be no new build. And they had borrowing ready of 40 million for new build, and that they've now cancelled that with the bank. So will that have an impact on our capital expenditure? Because that's not so much us borrowing, it's trying to help other people.
Well, we're obviously contributing towards the financing of some of that new housing activity, but the fiscal model has got to be sustainable. It's an issue we've also, Parliament and the government's got to be careful about in relation to the rent freeze questions and what implications that has. And we've got to be open about the any potential implications that come from that. But undoubtedly, it's an example of where there is an approach to co-investment, where we need other parties to be able to undertake fiscally sustainable measures.
So if housing associations are to build less, that will actually be a saving on the capital budget, presumably, for the government, because they will not be wanting the grants that they could have had?
Well, but then I come back to my answers to Liz Smith on the challenges that we face around realising economic opportunities. The housing challenges that we face are not just about the Highlands and Islands. You know, the convener's constituency will face acute challenges on this question in relation to housing availability and workforce, and the necessity to ensure that there is accommodation to contribute towards economic growth. So the last thing I want to see is any lack of constancy in the housing investment programme. It's not a capital saving that I would be particularly interested in pursuing.
I mean, talking of capital expenditure, we had evidence from South Lanarkshire Council that although, you know, we say inflation is 10, 11%, whatever it is, that actually in some capital projects, they were facing 30% inflation, for example, building a bridge because of the shortage of, I think, steel primarily, which I believe comes from Ukraine. Is that the kind of figure? Do you recognise that kind of inflation figure? So it's different in different sectors?
Without a doubt, yes. And there will be, you know, we've got to look with care at capital projects as to whether they can be, it's an issue I'm looking at all the time as to what are the expectations on capital projects because of the disruption that has taken place to supply chains from COVID, exacerbated by the illegal invasion of Ukraine and all the disruption that comes from that, the impact of energy costs. All of these factors are putting pressure on capital project budgets, and we've got to be very careful in the management of those sums.
And longer term, we've got a £3 billion limit, as I understand it, on borrowing for capital projects, and we're at about £2.1 billion at the moment. I mean, how do you see that moving forward, or do you think that £3 billion limit can be revised?
That would be the subject of, we would have to have necessary agreement with the Treasury about any revisions to those limits. And obviously, you know, these are issues that we pursue with the United Kingdom government.
Okay, and the final question, Convener, I was going to ask was about these investment zones that have been announced. I mean, my concern about all of these kind of things is that, well, we lose tax for one, and we have existing jobs move from one area to another just to get these kind of benefits. Can you say anything about these investment zones? Do we know anything about them?
I've had a couple of conversations with the Secretary of State for Levelling Up on these questions. The United Kingdom government are very keen that we develop a proposition in Scotland that is comparable to what has been taken forward in England. The Secretary of State has indicated to me that he understands fully the fact that many of the characteristics, aside from the national insurance contribution benefits that are contained, are essentially on devolved questions. And I've agreed to explore what those zones might look like. I think Mr. Mason puts to me some pretty fair points about these, the concept of investment zones and whether they actually generate, and this is, I suppose, the critical question, do they actually generate real new growth, or are they essentially providing for displacement? Because if they are only providing for displacement and there's an erosion of the tax value, then the growth estimates that the United Kingdom government are putting out will not be realised as a consequence. Yep. So there's, I think there's some very sensitive judgments we've got to make about that, but we are engaging in that discussion constructively with the United Kingdom government.
Okay, thanks so much. Thanks, Gillian.
Now, pass on to Michelle, who will be followed by Ross.
Thank you, and good morning, everybody, for coming along. Just picking up on the point around investment zones that John Mason brought forward. So it's good that some initial discussions have taken place, but I wanted to ask, do you have any initial concerns that monies will be made available for them that bypass the priorities of the Scottish Government with no proper accountability or scrutiny, as we've seen with some of the other levelling up type funds and so on that's been highlighted as a concern? Or have you got that far in your discussions yet?
I don't think there is a a tail of money likely to come with the investment zones. So we don't think there's a pot that comes with it. There will be fiscal incentives through reduced national insurance contributions, which is an issue which is properly within the competence of the United Kingdom government on the current constitutional arrangements. So, and the UK government is saying to us that they want the concept, they would like the concept to be extended to Scotland, but they properly understand there are many devolved issues and they want to proceed. So I've got no complaint about the nature and the manner of the dialogue that we're having on that question. And then some of the judgments come down to some of the issues that Mr Mason has already raised with me.
OK, thank you. And you've talked eloquently about last week's pretty disastrous fiscal event, and arguably too many in politics and perhaps even the media were too hasty to view the wider economic landscape through the prism of London. That often happens. But that budget or fiscal event talks to a culture, perhaps, of risk-taking, and we saw it with defined benefit pensions, where liability lies with the providers. In the Financial Times today, it has some stats about how much of, or the dwindling investment, I should say, of UK pensions in the domestic stock market. They say that as recently as the mid-1990s, pension funds allocated just under half of their assets to UK equities. That's a figure that's fallen to 15%. And the type of schemes that were caught up in the liquidity squeeze of last week, it's as low as allocating 3% of assets to UK equities. Now, that's frankly not a good sign, where you've got long-term patient capital vehicles reluctant to invest in their home turf and the alignment of that. So my question to you is, that one strikes me as a business opportunity for Scotland, where you are signalling a very prudent approach, aligned with the Scottish National Investment Bank, with long-term patient capital. So can you commit, are you able to commit, that all funding towards the Scottish National Investment Bank and indeed in long-term patient investment capital, you will do all you can to protect that and arguably even increase it, because it would be good if Scotland was seen as a place for some of these defined benefit schemes to invest, where they're not going to invest elsewhere.
I think it's always struck me throughout my involvement in many of these questions about the importance of investment certainty and to attract commitment to the market. And if I look, for example, at renewable energy, to take an example, we've given absolutely cast iron policy certainty since 2007 of our commitment to renewable energy. And I think the reason why we've made such phenomenal progress on getting to a position whereby essentially Scotland's net electricity requirements are generated in their entirety by renewable energy is because we've given that certainty to the marketplace. So I accept fundamentally the argument that Michelle Thompson puts to me. I think what she asked me to, and in relation to the Scottish National Investment Bank, the government's given a long-term commitment to the Scottish National Investment Bank, and although I'm not at the stage of defining particular budget numbers, the committee will understand I'm not quite at that stage yet, the government is committed to the long-term supporting of the Scottish National Investment Bank and all of its purposes. But I think, in all honesty, I can't assure Michelle Thompson that I can insulate Scotland from the damage that's been done by the Chancellor's decisions and the investment uncertainty that's been created. Because fundamentally, the pension funds that she talks about will look at the United Kingdom and they will look at the decisions of the United Kingdom government. And I'm not surprised that they're all very anxious and nervous about it, because it's been a total fiasco since a week past Friday. And it's just, I can't overstate the damage that has been done on top of an already really volatile situation by this fiscal recklessness. And I think, and I fear, I'm really worried that in order to go from this veering off to this extreme to that extreme to create market certainty, the casualty will be public spending. And the public spending that vulnerable people in our society depend upon. And that's my big fear about where we sit today.
And thank you for that. You've made that very clear both here today and elsewhere. One of the other reasons why the markets were so spooked, not just the lack of OBR look ahead, but also the fact that it was intended to borrow vast sums of money to fund tax cuts. Now, I had commented at the time that I wondered if the same people who were running gleefully to borrow money for that would be also running gleefully to press for an increase to the Scottish Government's borrowing powers, although we would both immediately agree I don't think the Scottish Government would be so stupid as to borrow money to fund tax cuts. But in the light of that, will you commit to an increased emphasis on further proper, flexible borrowing powers for the Scottish Government? Because again, this situation has laid bare the lack of fiscal resources available for you in the current economic climate.
I think there are a number of issues in there. The first is that I think there is a legitimate and proper space for borrowing for investment in our economy. And we have borrowing powers. Mr Mason asked me if they should be, the value of those should be increased, and there's always an argument for that. But I also would say there's also got to be fiscal sustainability. And, when finance ministers are setting budgets, they've got to be able to be confident we can service the debt that we take on. But borrowing for investment in the infrastructure of the country is absolute total common sense. And we do it, and we do it successfully. There is then the scenario of borrowing to deal with essentially the dynamics of change and fiscal shocks. So we have a small degree of borrowing capability to deal with a Scottish economic shock. And we have some fiscal flexibility about how much money we can carry over from year to year to deal with a Scottish economic shock. And we are using some of that flexibility just now to the maximum. It still doesn't stop me having to reduce public expenditure by 560, not reduce, to redirect £560 million of public expenditure from previously expected projects to meeting the in-year costs of essentially pay demands and inflationary pressures that are much greater than were anticipated when the budget was set. So I'm planning on the basis that I've got to find probably about £700 million in this financial year to fund pay deals, more than I anticipated. Hence why I'm having to make the changes that I'm making. Now, that there is an argument for saying, well, in these circumstances where you have inflation, which is currently 9.9% compared to 2% when the comprehensive spending review was undertaken, or even 5% when at the start of the financial year, there's an argument for us having some resource borrowing power to avoid us having to take some of the dramatic decisions I'm having to take. But we don't have that flexibility just now. I think it would be helpful to have those flexibilities. But again, I come back to my fundamental point. Those powers have got to be exercised in a climate of fiscal responsibility and sustainability, in whichever way we're exercising those powers.
Thank you very much. Just my final question, Convener, if that's okay. I'm on record in this place of talking about corruption and reframing the loss of those monies in GDP terms. People tend to look at corruption as crime, rather than a loss to GDP and therefore an inability to fund the vital public services we need. And I've quoted in a speech that conservative estimates put the lost UK GDP of around £267 billion each and every year. That's from the likes of the National Crime Agency. Now, just again, it's a short update if there's been any further discussions around the proceeds of crime in terms of prior to 2016, if it was less than 30 million, as I understand it, it was folded into the Scottish budget, and then post 2016, nothing has ever come to Scotland's budget, as I understand it, because the UK government have a different view. They regard it in terms of it should be deducted from Scotland's budget, whereas I think the Scottish government sees it under the no detriment principle. Given the loosening of regulation that's being trailed, that usually has a correlation with increased criminal activity. That's what we've seen. History tells us that. So have there been any further more recent discussions around proceeds of crime? Because in my opinion, that affects Scottish international brand. We don't want to be associated with that. And if not, will you undertake to look at that more closely, given the correlation between loss to GDP, which has an impact on Scotland as well?
There's two points in there. One is that I think we've got to be pretty realistic about the fact that I think the mini-budget, far from fuelling growth, has actually undermined growth. If we take the housing market alone, the disruption to the housing market will be significant as a consequence of what has happened because of the fiscal recklessness. So there is plenty of evidence of impact there. On the question of recent dialogue about the proceeds of crime, I think I'll need to write to the committee about that. It's a little while since I've dealt with that expressly, so I think just to make sure I can give the committee accurate answers, I better write to the convener about that.
Okay.
Thank you very much. If I can just ask one brief point of clarification. You set out very clearly there, Deputy First Minister, about the role of borrowing when it comes to investment, the role of borrowing when it comes to financial shocks. But you know, we hear dialogue from different parties, my own included, as though borrowing is some sort of infinite possibility for public expenditure. Would you agree with my view that by and large, in broad terms, that borrowing should not be used for current expenditure, that it is there to, I think, provide that flexibility around shocks and indeed investment, but you know, prudent financial management shouldn't be using borrowing to fund either tax cuts or indeed expansion in public spending in that way?
Generally, that should be the case, yes.
Thank you very much. And then just hand over to Ross.
Thanks, Convener, and apologies, Deputy First Minister, for missing your opening statement. Each stage of my journey in this morning was delayed by the weather. Following up on the comment you made a moment ago around the damage to the housing market, will the Government of Revenue Scotland in the coming weeks or months be in a position to issue revised projections for LBTT receipts, given the impact on mortgages?
We obviously monitor the position very carefully. The data for transactions and volumes and tax generated are published on a monthly basis, so the information will be available as to what has happened in relation to revenues, to numbers of transactions and to revenues. Obviously, if we decide to in any way change LBTT rates, that will be part of the projections that are undertaken, and obviously information in that respect will be set out to Parliament.
Thanks. The live data is very useful. What I was asking more about was assumptions the government might make. Let's say if we assume that there's no change for the purposes of these projections, assume there's no change to LBTT policy, projections of long-term income from that tax based on any assumptions around the effect on the housing market, because we can see, I'm quite sure, this month's data and next month's data will look bad, but there's a question for government there of trying to make some long-term assumptions for planning purposes and for how long that effect will be there and what long-term that effect will have, because that does then affect discussions around LBTT policy.
There will be, there's a short-term there's an immediate short-term issue that revenue might not realise our expectations. Equally, it might exceed our expectations, but, you know, I think there'll be a substantial interruption to the housing market going on just now, so I think it's likely that there will be an undermining of revenues as a consequence. Obviously, the forecasts that we undertake are designed to provide as much certainty as we can about the implications of policy decisions that we make. So we will be essentially mapping out what those approaches to policy will be, securing projections on the basis of those policies, and taking financial decisions accordingly. But these factors are material to the performance of the budget.
Thanks. I've got one technical question that maybe I should know the answer to this already. But how is the interest rate set for the National Loans Fund? I'm conscious that in recent years, I think loans, it's been less than 1.5%. But given expectation of the resource the government's going to draw from that fund over the coming years, changes to that interest rate could have a relatively significant long-term effect. But I'm not clear how that interest rate's set.
I think over UK borrowing costs is usually what flows through to the NLF. I can't remember off the top of my head, but it's a very small premium that we have managed to secure through the NLF on our borrowing to date. I'm not sure what the forecasts are. That
it's issued as UK government debt essentially, and there's a small premium, so it comes in under whatever the cost of UK government debt is over 5, 10 or whatever years. So that will obviously increase given the term level last week.
But we can perhaps, it might be helpful if we write to the committee just to give absolute clarity about those details.
That would be useful, yeah, thank you. One wider question, you might be aware of some of the evidence that we've taken in recent weeks from various stakeholders, and as you would expect, absolutely everybody believes that their sector should be prioritised for additional public spending. Very few are willing to volunteer where that money might come from. Like, almost no one's willing to volunteer a cut in another area. Some organisations have come to us with revenue-raising proposals, though, so I would commend Unison's to you. They're some of the most specific proposals I've seen in quite some time. But amongst those organisations who simply say, well, you can fund the extra spending that we think we need from tax increases, it tends to be quite vague. It tends to just be a statement of, oh, well, there are more tax powers to be used than are currently being used. I certainly interpret that in part to be down to a lack of familiarity with the data that is currently available on tax and spend in Scotland. So, for example, a lot of these organisations probably aren't particularly familiar with the fact that the Ready Reckoners are published each year on income tax. They would certainly struggle if they were coming up with their own proposals around reform of LBTT or council tax, etc. How do you think we can improve the quality of public debate and public knowledge, or certainly amongst key stakeholder groups, not necessarily the public at large, but around the tax side of the equation at budget time? Because otherwise we will continue to be stuck in the loop we've been in for a long time of everybody coming and asking for more money and saying what's simply up to Parliament and government to decide where that comes from. How do we improve the quality of debate around actually raising that revenue?
I think there's a number of things that we have to do here, because I think the way in which Mr. Greer characterises a lot of the debate, I think, is entirely accurate. I've had various discussions in the course of my limited period of return to the public finance role, where people have told me to invariably use the reserves, they're all being used, borrow, can't borrow, increase tax, can't by law increase tax, or finally get down the back of the sofa and see what's there. These four options do not provide answers to the challenge I face, which is hence my statement to Parliament on the 7th of September. I think some of the answer to this lies in the points I exchanged with Liz Smith in the Programme for Government debate and in our earlier discussion, that we really have got to have in Parliament a totally realistic, open discussion about the relationship between tax and spending, and what we're prepared to argue for in spending terms, we've got to be prepared to argue for in tax terms. And I use tax as a catch-all for tax, revenue raising, level of borrowing, whatever, the income side of things. So, yeah, let's have that proper discussion. And I'm very open to that discussion because, you know, I'm not sitting here saying there's easy answers. There's really difficult decisions going to have to be taken, and we're going to have that open kind of climate. A couple of things. I'm not sure if Mr. Greer heard this from my opening statement, but there are two things that I'm doing this year which I hope will help in this respect. The first is that I have invited three significant economic voices to provide some commentary into our debate, dispassionately, for them to construct their contribution. Professor Anton Muscatelli, Professor Francis Ruane, and Professor Mike Brewer. So I've asked them to, I had a briefing session with them last week, and I've invited them to reflect on the issues that we are wrestling with, and actually I suspect the proceedings of this committee this morning will be quite a helpful reference point for them in considering these points. And they'll make contributions to the debate where they will set out some of the issues that we've got to consider. And then the second thing is that I expect that group will make a couple of interventions in the debate, but there'll be interventions not to make recommendations. I've told them I don't want recommendations. That's up to me to decide what to do and to put to Parliament. But I want them to try to help inform commentary and discussion about this, so to be as dispassionate as possible. And then the second thing I'm going to do is that I am going to open up a consultation process on the various challenges that we face on tax and spending. And I'll publish a discussion paper to encourage public engagement on these choices on tax and public expenditure. And I'd expect to do that sometime around about the timing of the emergency budget review.
Thanks. And just one final question for time, convener. Just around what the government's latest expectations are of the effect of fiscal drag this year on income tax receipts.
We're looking at all of these questions as part of assembling our judgments about the position that we have to resolve in relation to our tax proposals around the budget. We'll obviously set that out to Parliament as part of the commentary on the budget and the judgments that we think are relevant at that time.
Thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you, Ross.
I hand over to Douglas.
Thank you, Convener. Deputy First Minister, I just wanted to go back on investment zones. It sounded like you're not fundamentally against them, but you just need to see a lot more detail and description from the UK government. Would that be a fair analysis?
The UK government basically would like to see this idea rolled out across the whole of the United Kingdom. They can provide essentially a foundation for it in the national insurance contribution concessions that are made, but some of the detailed specific provisions that are in the English guidance document, which I've had a look at, are essentially in devolved issues, and they're mostly around about some planning and environmental considerations and a variety of other questions. So the UK government is engaging us properly on the substance of those. I think the issues I would have, I rehearsed some of them with Mr. Mason. I think we've got to be careful about some of these questions about the effect of displacement as to whether it is actually generating new economic activity and other alternative ways in which we can support that. But I assure Mr. Lumsden that we're engaging in that process in a constructive spirit, and the UK government is engaging constructively with us on that as well.
And that's good to hear, 'cause I would imagine there's quite a lot of similarities between this new investment zones and also free ports. So has there been much work done by the Scottish Government yet on free ports, and whether that will just be displacement, will it be new growth and the cost to the Scottish Government that having a free port model might bring?
These are some of the same and relevant issues apply. There's obviously, we are still in discussions with the UK Government about the agreement that was reached before, which was for there to be two green free ports in Scotland. And obviously, bearing in mind my point about displacement, if we have too many of these, bluntly, if we have too many of these things, then we're just, it's just all swirling around. But I think Mr. Lumsden understands the point I'm making.
Yeah, absolutely. But would it also be the same argument about maybe some of the benefits would actually be devolved benefits and you know, the impact onto the your budget from that, I guess?
Potentially, but they obviously, you know, they flow into you know, they flow into the level of growth that we can assume within Scotland, and along with a range of other factors.
Okay. Next question I had was around air passenger duty, because that was obviously an area that could potentially be devolved. Is that still something that the government are looking at, or is that something that you're moving away from now?
The last discussions we had on this were some time ago, because of some of the challenging issues around the devolution of air passenger duty, and from my knowledge, those issues have not been yet resolved.
Not yet, no, no.
So bent it being devolved, is that correct? Okay, that's good to know. Last question I had was around National Care Service. So, Deputy First Minister, you said that really difficult financial times. Just now. So is that one area that you're maybe looking at again? Is it the right time then to introduce that extra layer? Because as a committee, you know, we hear quite a lot of evidence from people who say it could add an extra layer of bureaucracy, and maybe that now is not the right time to do it. Is that something that you'd consider delaying, or is it definitely something you want to push ahead with?
The government's taken forward the legislation on the National Care Service, and we're developing those propositions. Obviously, there's a lot of consultation and dialogue going on those points. I think fundamentally, we've not really got into today specific funding decisions about particular areas of policy. So I wouldn't want to give commitments on particular decisions that the government is making on any aspect of policy, other than to say that what we've committed to doing, we intend to fund, but it all has to be fiscally sustainable, and that's the challenge that I'm wrestling with in this financial year, because of we've had a number of significantly increased costs in this year through pay deals principally, and the loss of value through inflation. So we've got to make sure that all of our current delivery of the budget is fiscally sustainable, and we've got to make sure that future years are fiscally sustainable as well.
And do we have updated costs on the National Care Service, or is that something that will come through in the legislation that's going to be provided?
That will be set out in the financial memorandum that's associated with the bill.
Okay. Thank you. Thanks, Camina.
Thank you very much. Clearly, my comments about time discipline has instilled a remarkable discipline upon the committee. I think it might even be the first time anyone has ever followed my lead. But it does mean that we have some time for some supplementary questions. So I was just going to invite Liz to ask a supplementary. I have one or two, but indeed, if other committee members have any supplementary questions, we do have time in hand. Liz.
Thank you, convener. I was interested in what you said in response to Mr. Greer about the need for a grown-up discussion within the Parliament about what we bring in through revenue and what we spend. And I don't think there's any doubt, Mr. Swinney, that you know, increasing transparency and accountability in this Parliament is absolutely essential. And I think it was 2 weeks ago we had witnesses here who were very keen on that idea. In fact, a couple of the witnesses were suggesting that we should have a finance bill to try to enhance that process. And I'm interested to know your views on that, because it comes on the back of, you know, the National Performance Framework, which is obviously centre stage to the Scottish Government's delivery. And we've had a lot of debates about how easy is it when you have specific policies within the National Performance Framework to measure the outcomes. How easy is that process? Could I ask you if you are minded to be fairly favourable towards the idea of a finance bill that could help enhance this scrutiny and just the openness?
I don't think, convener, at any stage in my answer to Mr. Greer did I use the words grown up, because I think I possibly argued for a more considered discussion. But I'm all for that, because I think, you know, if I don't mean this disrespectfully to anybody, because, you know, I'm as much a player in this as anybody else, but, you know, we probably need to have a bit more of a considered debate in Parliament about some of these questions. And I give the committee the assurance I'm going to endeavour to try to do that through my stewardship of this brief for, hopefully for a very short period of time if the Finance Secretary happens to be listening into this session. But I've tried to demonstrate that by coming to Parliament with a statement on the 7th of September, which is not a statement I was required to make, but I made it because I felt, in the interest of openness and transparency, I should tell Parliament what I was doing to wrestle with the in-year financial pressures. Normally, that would all be done in the autumn and spring budget revision process. That doesn't attract an awful lot of attention, and there are some really substantial issues that we're wrestling with. So I do think there is a need for us to have that open, considered discussion. Whether we need more legislation to do it, I'm not persuaded, because I think, actually, going back to what we've talked about the existing legislative framework on the Scottish Fiscal Commission, I think that puts some pretty substantial obligations on government to adhere to the contents of the legislation and for Parliament to be informed by the Fiscal Commission of its conclusions and its views. But I'm very happy to consider any further points and references that can be relevant. I think the connection to the discussion about the National Performance Framework is an interesting one, because I accept that it is difficult to look at a pound in the budget and just follow its journey into the National Performance Framework. I think it's possible to look at the National Performance Framework periodically and say, do we think public expenditure and policy decisions are supporting the achievement of this direction of travel? And if not, then what do we need to reshape about public expenditure to enable that to be, or policy, to enable that to be more the case? But it's a difficult process to establish a direct connection between public expenditure and outcomes. I think a fair conclusion would be to look at decisions on public expenditure and, for example, come to the conclusion, do we think the government is doing enough to support early intervention and preventative measures? Because, you know, if the government is spending all of its time running around picking up the pieces of things and not actually leaping away upstream and trying to avoid problems occurring, then, you know, I think that's a pretty big debate for Parliament to have. But then that would also probably lead to changes in how we spend public expenditure. To go back to Mr. Greer's point, there isn't often a queue of people saying, oh, please take money away from me because it could be better spent over there. But Parliament could always have that decision and agree collectively, actually, we could do with, you know, let's take early intervention. I'm a firm believer in early intervention. It's why we've got the investment that we made on early learning and childcare to expand to 1,140 hours, because, you know, Cabinet came to the conclusion we needed to take a bold decision to alter the life chances of children in our society. Same rationale affected the decision to embark on the Scottish Child Payment. So we took big, bold policy and financial, with policy decisions with financial implications, and we've put them into the budget in the hope that they help to narrow the attainment gap and that they help us to erode child poverty. And, you know, I would argue there's real benefit in those policy decisions, but they've come at a price in terms of the cost to the budget. And Parliament obviously is welcome to air some of those questions as we proceed.
Thank you.
If I may just ask a couple of supplementary questions. One, which follows on. Indeed, just offer one brief comment. I mean, you're absolutely right, Deputy First Minister. It is difficult to follow a pound from the budget through to national performance framework. I'd also gently submit that it's quite difficult to follow a pound through to even kind of the outturn. And I know the government has announced some changes to some of the processes, but I mean, I think, you know, for a grown-up and candid discussion, being able to follow the pound as effectively as possible, which isn't always easy, I think is important. But more specifically on preventative spend, some preventative spend is difficult because it takes many years to actually follow through. Some is a little bit more immediate. We had very good evidence in our evidence gathering from Engender making a plea for investment in social care, both because of the gendered impact that can have, with women representing a disproportionate proportion of the social care workforce. But I mean, we also know in the most recent figures in July, although I think there are more numbers out today, that there were 55,992 days spent in hospital from those people whose discharge was delayed. So I was just wondering, does the government have a view of what the cost of that is? And indeed, is it undertaking a cost-benefit analysis of what it might, the impact might be if you increased pay of social care workers and thereby reduce the number of vacancies? And is that the sort of work that will be undertaken in advance of the budget?
There's a couple of really significant issues in there, convener. The following public expenditure to outturn, I'm happy to look at what further information would be helpful in that respect. But from budget proposals to budget enactment is to then autumn revision and spring revision to outturn, there's quite a number of steps that are set out there. I appreciate by the time it gets to outturn, the numbers are quite high level, but inevitably there are large numbers of budgets that perform as we expect. Some go either side of our expectation, and we try to display that information by the revisions that are made at autumn and spring, and ultimately report on that in the outturn. But if there are changes we can make there, I'm certainly happy to engage on those questions. I think the second point that you raise in relation to social care is a fundamental issue. The level of delayed discharge is way, way too high, and it's a source of enormous concern to ministers. And we've taken a number of steps and had taken forward a number of discussions to try to resolve this, including a lot of dialogue with local authorities to tackle this. I think fundamentally, the problem of delayed discharge is a product of at least two factors, and it may be a third. Of the two, I am certain is that our systems are not yet proactive enough and sufficiently preventative to support people at home to avoid them getting into a position of having to go into hospital. Now, there's lots and lots of good work goes on around the country of low-level care packages, delivering support to people, just enough to keep people in their own homes and to keep them supported. And there's a whole variety of public and third sector support services that assist people in that endeavour. But I would have to accept that there's probably not enough of them, resulting then in some people being admitted to hospital who really we should be able to support in home to avoid them getting there in the first place. And once they get there, and part of the problem with A&E waiting times is because our hospitals are congested in general, which means that some people are coming in the front door of A&E that shouldn't be, and some people are not who need to come in the front door of A&E and need to go out the back door of A&E into the hospital can't make that journey quick enough because the hospital is congested with people who really should be out of the hospital and back home. And they're not at home because we don't have sufficient capacity in care packages to support people who might need higher volume care packages to be supported at home than the people I talked about in the other category who might just need very modest amounts of social care support. And what is all that about? I don't think it is about the third thing, which I'm debating in my mind, is the availability of money. Because actually, for once, I don't think there's a shortage of money in social care. The issue is shortage of people. And that then comes back to a point where we have lost a lot of people from social care. If I think about my own community that I represent, a lot of people delivering social care were people that had come in from other countries and were providing that support. And a lot of them have gone away. And the other issue that I have to, for completeness, recognise is your point to me, Convener, which I acknowledge you have made on many occasions in parliamentary debate, is that social care salaries may not be high enough to attract people in making choices between different areas of economic activity. And we've obviously undertaken a local government pay deal, which has been designed to strengthen pay for those at the lower end of the pay levels, and I hope that might help us on that journey. But we've got to remain open to the legitimate issue you put to us.
Thank you. And I've had indications of supplementaries from both Douglas and Michelle. Can I just ask, just before that, though, a brief clarification, just in terms of the response to the emerge, the mini budget on the 24th that you've committed to making. You alluded to the fact that there is some ambiguity around actually what the consequentials might be. Indeed, Spice, I believe, have published some analysis of what that might look like. And what it, certainly the indications are from that work is that in this current financial year, the consequentials might be as little as 35 million, but depending on what the government might do in its latter years. So, first of all, does the Scottish Government have a view of what the quantum might be, both this and next financial year? And secondly, it strikes me that there's a question of priorities. Does the Scottish Government could seek to reverse some of the decisions that it made early in September? It might seek to replicate decisions of the UK government, or it might seek to do targeted things with the additional money it may or may not have. Do you have a view of which of those three should be the priority, just in terms of setting an expectation of what may or may not happen in your statement on the week commencing the 24th of October?
I think we should be clear. I wrote to the committee yesterday with a revised assessment from Her Majesty's His Majesty's Treasury of their estimate of the impact on Scottish block grant adjustments arising from the UK government's income tax and stamp duty land tax policy changes. And that indicates a potential positive block grant adjustment of £35 million in this financial year, which assumes that we do not make any changes to land and buildings transaction tax within this financial year in relation to stamp duty. Now, as I've said to the committee already, I think the disruption to the property market will put a great deal of uncertainty over those numbers. In relation to the emergency budget review, the purpose of the emergency budget review, which I commenced before the fiscal event, was essentially to explore what more the Scottish Government could do in targeted support to assist people who are facing financial challenge. And that remains the purpose of the exercise. I obviously have been looking with care at the UK government's changes to income tax and stamp duty land tax. And my thinking at this stage is that given the turmoil that we're experiencing, given the importance that's attached to an orderly process of forecasting, that any tax changes should be made within the normal budget process that the Scottish Government takes forward.
Thank you very much. That's very helpful. I'd like to hand over to Douglas for a supplementary and then Michelle.
Yeah, thank you. Deputy First Minister, the resource spending review mentioned quite a lot about public sector reform. When will we start seeing a flavour of what that's actually going to mean for Scotland?
Obviously, there's a number of steps underway under the COVID recovery strategy, which envisage a great deal, essentially a focus on person-centred delivery of public services. That requires a great deal of alignment of activity from a range of different organisations. So the work on taking forward that approach is very much a constant part of the policy agenda being taken forward with our local authority partners and with our with the National Health Service and other players. So that's about reforming the way in which we deliver services so that we support people more directly rather than essentially relying on people to link up public services themselves. The second area I would highlight is obviously we're looking very carefully at the functions of different organisations, and colleagues have set out to Parliament some of that work, whether that's in the field of education or skills, or the work that's underway in relation to the National Care Service. Lastly, we have got the work that I've highlighted in the discussions we've had at committee this morning about the public sector workforce and the range and selection of tasks that we expect to be undertaken as part of ensuring the public sector is appropriately sized and equipped to meet the challenges that we face.
So I guess it's then a case of little snippets here and there as opposed to a big bang approach where we see a total change to the landscape, so to speak.
If Mr Lumsden is waiting for me to announce a reorganisation of local government boundaries, then I shall save him the worry, if he's worried about that, that won't be part of what we're looking at. Okay. But actually, as I, once I complete this session of the committee, I'm going off to take part in a cabinet subcommittee on joint priorities with local government, so many of these issues feature in that discussion.
Okay, thank you. Thanks, Camino.
Indeed, I think we've had enough of big bangs from finance ministers in recent weeks. Michelle.
Thank you. It's not often I get the last word in any of these sessions. And I'm looking here at four men on the panel, but I'm really reminded that significant structural inequalities still remain in the economy for women. COVID's had a big impact. The cost crisis has had a disproportionate effect. And I'm mindful of the fact that Close the Gap suggests that if the gap was narrowed, it could add £17 billion to the Scottish economy. And a view they express, but with which I strongly agree, that equality must be seen as an economic issue and not an equalities issue. So can I ask if you'll give a commitment today to test every element of what you bring forward for the Scottish budget as to its impact on women, both in terms of contribution and by reduction?
Can I reassure Michelle Thompson that although she is faced by a quartet of men today, on any other day, if the Director General Exchequer had been with me or the Chief Financial Officer had been with me, the panel would have looked remarkably different. So just to reassure Michelle Thompson that we have very appropriate levels of gender balance across Scottish Government if we don't have it in the panel today. Indeed, if the Finance Minister was actually here, it'd be very different as well. So I'll just give that other encouragement for her to come back to her role as quickly as possible. The To be absolutely serious, I unreservedly accept the points made by Michelle Thompson about the importance of assessing the impact of budget measures on women and on a variety of different groupings and considerations within our society. We are very fortunate in Scotland of having the Scottish Women's Budget Group, who have been very much involved in the budget and financial planning work of the Scottish Government for many years. They were very actively involved when I was Finance Minister in the past. I know that the Government has good dialogue with, and I'll meet the Scottish Women's Budget Group as part of the dialogue I take forward on the budget, and I will listen carefully to the representations that they make, as I do to a range of different organisations. I think it is important that in the construction of our budget, it is important that we take adequate account of the impact it may have on different groupings, and particularly on women in our society. But it's probably even more important that if we have to take tough decisions during a financial year, we pay particular attention to those issues as well, because to avoid getting into the situation of creating any impact that would in any way be negative in that process.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Michelle. And with that, it was quite pleasing for me that as we approach 11:20, and according to my schedule here, I can report that we are on time, and certainly while it might not be quite true to say that we're on budget, we've certainly been on the budget this morning. So can I thank the Deputy First Minister for his contribution this morning, and indeed for the support of his officials with him. And with that, we now move into private session. Thank you very much.